I call this meeting the Williamsburg James City County School Board to order. Ms. Serza, could you take the role, please?
Here.
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 Mr. Kelly.
Here. Dr. Beers is out of town this week, so he is not able to attend. 3.01, certification of closed session. Can I have a motion, please?
I certify that to the best of each member's knowledge, the Williamsburg James City County School Board, while in closed session, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Miner.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Thank you. 4.01, approval of the agenda. Can I have a motion for approval of the agenda, please?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of the agenda as presented, but with the following amendments, please. I'd like to have 7.02 be a resolution in appreciation of Dr. Constantino. 7.03, appointment of Dr. Heron as acting superintendent. And then that would move 7.04 to tuition rates and 7.05 to use of facilities.
Very well. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Ms. Miner.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Thank you. 5.01, announcement superintendent's report. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly, members of the board. Good evening, everyone. Last Tuesday, all of WJCC leadership staff participated in the first ever regional Excellence Through Equity Conference held in Virginia Beach. Over 700 leaders from all of Region 2 schools gathered to talk about this very important topic. I'd like to thank Dr. Heron for being our representative to the planning committee, which met for most of the last year, and Mr. Kelly for attending and spending the day with the leadership. It was an excellent conference and will certainly drive leadership thinking and development this year. On Wednesday and Thursday of last week, a team of educators, including myself and Mrs. Cook, participated in the Classrooms Not Courtrooms conference in Richmond. Again, this was an excellent conference which highlighted strategies to keep our kids in school and successful. We appreciate Mrs. Cook devoting 2 days of her schedule to this important conference. I also want to acknowledge that our division was presented with the Trailblazer Award for our work in the area of student supports for staying in school. Lastly, I'd like to thank the WJCC Schools Foundation for an excellent retreat held this past Sunday afternoon. It was a great afternoon of good discussion and planning for a bigger and better grant cycle this year. Almost the entire board was present on a Sunday afternoon in the middle of the summer. I very much appreciate the dedication of the WJCC Foundation Board and their hard work in support of innovation in our classrooms. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Dr. Constantino. Any other board members with announcements or I would just like to say I appreciated the invite to the Excellence Through Equity Conference. I took a lot away from it personally, and I was also very impressed with the engagement of our staff in the learning and in the participation in the conference and the breakout sessions. There was a lot of good thought going in there, and that was very impressive and very appreciative. And it's unfortunate that not more get to see the good hard work of our admin staff. So that brings us to 6.01, citizens' comments. I believe we have one card this evening. Mrs. Hummel?
It is at this point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the school board. Those citizens desiring to speak have submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. When a speaker's name is called, the speaker comes to the podium and states his or her name for the record and directs his or her comments to the chair of the board. In order to promote a listening and respectful environment, please avoid applauding, verbal outbursts, or any other type of demonstration when the speaker is addressing the school board. Personnel matters are not considered in public meetings. The school board requests that all speakers refrain from making any reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. The school board's role is to listen to the speaker rather than to respond to his or her comments. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes to make his or her comments. The school board asks each speaker to respect this time limitation. Time may not be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated.
Thank you, Mrs. Hummel. Mrs. Cook?
Edith Hurd.
Good evening. My name is Edith Hurd, and I'm a resident of Williamsburg, James City County, for 75 years. I want to thank you all, and the Black community truly thanks you for allowing your board to accept the change of the school name. However, there is one issue in the community that we are discussing, and that is, why do we need to wait 10 years if we want to name the school after an individual? 10 years does not make that much difference, simply because it's been over 40 years with Mr. Byrd, and we are changing it. So what the community would like to see you do is, when you do name a school after an individual, that you have done as much check as possible before you do this. And then maybe the time period could be 5 years or less. But the 10-year period doesn't make it any difference if they have not been good for the community from day one, because it will come out. But I would like to thank you for allowing that to happen, that action. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Hurd. That brings us to our action items for this evening. 7.1, personnel actions. Can I have a motion for approval of the personnel agenda?
Mr. Chairman, I move the adoption of personnel actions at 7.01 as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 7.02, can I get a motion for approval of the resolution in appreciation of Dr. Stephen Constantino?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of agenda item 7.02, resolution in appreciation of Dr. Constantino.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Before we have our discussion, I'll read the resolution, although I think I might not read every paragraph of the resolution, because I know you don't want me to read it at all, but I'm going to enjoy that. Resolution in appreciation of Stephen M. Constantino, ED. Whereas after 5.5 years as superintendent of Williamsburg James City County Public Schools, Stephen M. Constantino will now help lead the Commonwealth of Virginia's efforts to improve schools as the chief academic officer, assistant superintendent for instruction at the Virginia Department of Education. And I'll skip that paragraph. Whereas Dr. Constantino hit the ground running in Williamsburg James City County Public Schools and provided immediate guidance and leadership that was instrumental in the development of WJCC's 5-year strategic plan, and then in ensuring division initiatives and measures of performance aligned with the mission, values, and goals of the plan. Whereas under Dr. Constantino's tutelage, WJCC has maintained full state accreditation, one of the few school divisions to do so in Virginia, improve graduation rates and lower dropout rates, and save thousands of taxpayer dollars through the implementation of APQC efficiency procedures. And whereas, as the recipient of one of only 5 Virginia high school redesign grants, Dr. Constantino spearheaded the division's development of the Pathways Project of War Hill High School, an innovative instructional program designed to provide students with a personal, meaningful, and relevant personalized learning opportunity. And whereas, as a nationally recognized leader and author of 4 books on family engagement, Dr. Constantino's expertise benefited local, state, and national initiatives, including the Virginia School Boards Association Challenging Schools Task Force, where he wrote the family and community engagement section of that group's report to the governor. And whereas Dr. Constantino ably and professionally represented the school division when he served on the James City County Strategic Planning Steering Committee, gave several presentations at multiple VSBA and NSBA conference, and when he was named as the Region 2 Superintendent of the Year in 2015. And whereas Dr. Constantino's efforts to strengthen community and governmental relationships are evident through the creation of the first WJCC Foundation dedicated to financially supporting classroom innovation, the Superintendent's Business and Community Advisory Committee sponsorship of a revamped and expanded Teacher of the Year recognition program, and the ultimate funding of the approval and funding of the fourth middle school is set to open in 2018. Now therefore be it resolved that on the second day of August 2016, the School Board of Williamsburg, James City County expresses its appreciation for Dr. Stephen M. Constantino's dedicated service to the students, staff, and families of Williamsburg, James City County Public Schools. Are there any discussion from board members? On that note, as I said at the beginning of this, Dr. Constantino was adamant that he did not want us to make a big deal about his departure.
Yes, I was.
But this isn't about or for him. This is about the community thanking him for his contributions to our school system and to our community. He's brought process and strategic planning to our school system that was not here on his arrival. He's brought administrative leadership, which has achieved results in this community. A true measure of a leader is the talent which he attracts and which he surrounds himself with. We're going to be talking a little bit more about that in just a minute, but we're very appreciative of the senior administrations and the administration in our schools. Our system has seen the development of an education foundation, accreditation of all our schools, and outstanding student achievement. There's still work to be done, no doubt, but thank you for what you have done. Our loss is the Commonwealth's gain. Best wishes on your new adventures, and don't forget about your friends here in WJCC. So, thank you, sir.
We should vote.
Oh. We should vote, then we'll take a picture.
We should vote on it.
So, Ms. Thurs?
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Minor?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. So, if all of us could come forward here and get in the picture. That includes you. Thank you. That moves us along to item 7.03, appointment of Dr. Olwin Herron as acting superintendent. Is there a motion?
I move that Dr. Olwin Herron be appointed to the position of acting superintendent effective August 16th to serve until the appointment and qualification of a new superintendent or until June 30th, 2017, whichever comes first, and that Dr. Herron receives an annual salary of $175,000.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion from board members?
Sure. So I want to thank Dr. Constantino and for your leadership, and I should have said that earlier. I apologize for not doing that. I'm very excited about this opportunity to work closely with Dr. Herron, who does an amazing job for this division. So I hope that you'll consider favorably our request to have you serve as acting superintendent.
Is there any discussion from other board members? I would just like to say we are privileged to have Dr. Herron agree to serve as the acting superintendent of WJCC schools and provide leadership and stability as we move forward into the 2016-2017 school year. Dr. Herron earned a doctorate degree from Regent University, a master's degree from the Queen's University in Belfast, and a Bachelor of Arts with honors from the University of Liverpool. She has had leadership positions in school systems from Williamsburg to Texas to Virginia Beach, Oklahoma, and Northern Ireland. The Kelly in me loves that. WJCC has already benefited from her wide-ranging and vast experience, and I appreciate her agreeing to step up into this new role as the acting superintendent. Thank you, Dr. Heron, for your help and leadership. We look forward to working with you and supporting you as we approach and get into this academic year. Is there anything you would like to say to us and to...
Good evening, Dr. Kelly, members of the board. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I am honored to serve as acting superintendent, and I'm ready to build on the wonderful things that Dr. Constantino has done as a leader of the system. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Ms. Serza.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Miner.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Thank you. Thank you. Agenda item 7.04, can I get a motion to approve tuition rates for non-resident schools for 2016-2017 school year at the rate of regular education, $9,623, and special education, $17,841.
Mr. Chair, I move to approve item 7.04, tuition rates for non-resident students for 2016-17 school year, regular education in the amount of $9,623, and special education in the amount of $17,841.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Moved and seconded to approve the tuition rates for non-resident students for 2016-17 school year at the regular education, $9,623, and special education, $17,841. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Ms. Miner.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Thank you. 7.05, can I get a motion to approve the request for use of facilities by Unity Christian Church of Virginia at James River Elementary School to use James River Elementary School for church services on Sunday mornings until they build or find permanent facilities or until May 7th, 2017?
Mr. Chair, I move to approve the request for use of facilities by Unity Christian Church of Virginia at James River Elementary School to use James River Elementary School for church services on Sunday mornings until they build or find permanent facilities or until May 7th, 2017.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Moved and seconded to approve the request for use of facilities by Unity Christian Church of Virginia at James River Elementary School to use James River Elementary School for church services on Sunday mornings until they build, find permanent facilities or until May 7th, 2017. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Miner.
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. That takes us to our proposed agenda items, 8.01, proposed process for school renaming. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members of the board, at the July 12th meeting, the board asked the administration to propose a process for the renaming of Rawls Byrd Elementary School. This came after the May 24th vote in which the board voted to change the name of the elementary school. Also on July 12th, the board voted on policy FFA school names, and that policy also does indicate that the process for school renaming shall be the same as is stated in that policy. So taking the verbiage from the new policy regarding input from the public, and the board's reserving the right to make a final decision regarding the name of any school or school facility, we have outlined a potential process for your consideration. And the process mirrors is similar to that of those that have been used in other school systems around the Commonwealth. And it's a I don't think that it would be unfamiliar to you. I think that this ad hoc kind of work has happened before in the district for various reasons. This would be the same concept in which we would put together a very specific committee of people, which included school staff, the principal of the school, teachers and staff members at the school, parents at the school, and then, of course, community members at large. We've heard from a large variety of community members about the renaming of the school. And then we've suggested some charges that the board may wish to consider for the committee with regard to allowing the committee to develop a mechanism or mechanisms to solicit input from the community, determine their own process by which the most popular suggestions can be vetted, and then present to you three potential names for the school. At that point, upon acceptance of those three potential names, the school board can then determine if and how it wishes to proceed with regard to the selection of the final name. At the conclusion of the process, the board obviously would vote on the renaming of Rawls Byrd Elementary School, and then the division would begin the process of physically making the changes necessary to rename the school. We've also proposed to you in this a proposed timeline. You'll recall in early conversations, there was some concern from the voting, what's the name of the office? I'm drawing a blank. Thank you, the registrar's office, with regard to polling places and changing the names of polling places. So it's impossible for us to do this quickly because of that. And so it seemed logical then that we take the time through the year with beginning in August with your charge to the administration, if you either accept this idea or some version of it after your conversation, that the committee would begin their work in the fall. They would make an initial report and recommendation to you in January. You would then have January to March, if you needed it, to determine the process for selecting the permanent name, and then you would vote on that, obviously. And then that would give the school division, primarily the operations department and school staff, making the necessary changes to school signage between May and July. And then September 2017, the school would open under a new name. So that's the basic outline of the process that you asked for. And again, it's a start and certainly open to your suggestion, recommendation, or change.
Thank you. Is there any discussion from board members?
Yes, I appreciate the work that the school division has done on this. My only question is, that is a lot of people on a committee. Was there some rationale for that number of people?
Yes. Most of the ad hoc committees that we have between 12 and 15 people. We're fairly comfortable in working with a committee that size. And it came down to the people that need to be there and making sure that their voice is represented. And so I'm not concerned about the number of people. I think it ends up being 12. Is that correct? 5, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And I think we've had committees of as large as 15, which have worked. Our calendar committee strikes me as a committee that's a little bit larger than that every year. So I'm fairly comfortable with the size of that committee and the ability to work with them.
Okay, my one other question is, who is the Director of Public Relations and Engagement?
Ms. Overcamp-Smith.
That's what I thought. Okay, thank you. I just wanted to clarify that.
Any other?
Yeah, I have three questions and then an observation. So help me understand how we would go about selecting the non-school, the other members of the committee. How does that process going to happen? What might that look like?
Well, you have a couple of options. Obviously, the principal can select staff members or have a process inside the building. Select. I would leave it to the principal to select staff and parents from the school.
Okay.
And in terms of community members, I think we would want to make sure that we have a representation of various opinions, you know, we've heard from a lot of people, and I think there are some people that have spoken to the board that would be appropriate for that committee. So I won't sit here and say that has all been fleshed out, because this was the beginning of a recommendation, but I think we can fairly quickly develop a process to ensure that the committee is filled and it is well represented.
Am I correct in thinking that the committee will decide how they're going to solicit the names from the community. I know that we set a standard about the name will come with somebody who identifies themselves and a reason for the name, but are we, have, will the committee decide how they do that? Whether it be public or website, whatever?
When we discussed it and we thought about it, you'll see that we said that we would charge the committee to develop that mechanism. And you certainly have the opportunity to develop the mechanism yourself, but it seemed to me that when thinking about this, the more that we could empower the community to determine how and when and why and who, it seemed to be a better option. I think the committee will wrestle with, okay, what are we going to do? And how are we going to do it? And, but we left that purposely kind of open.
Then my last is, since it's not an unreasonable size for the committee, I would encourage us to add another community member to take that to three. Just I think it would be helpful, since we did have so many speakers from for various groups that represent the community, but that would be my only other suggestion on that.
And let me be clear, if I haven't been, this is an initial recommendation.
Okay.
If we're happy to make whatever changes the board wishes, and you know, the committee size, committee makeup processes are all open to your input and your discretion.
Ms. Hummel?
Thank you for putting this together, and I like the timeline. I think that makes total sense. It's measured. It's thoughtful. It gives everyone enough time to feel comfortable with the new decision. I agree with Mrs. Miner. I would almost flip-flop the representation of the parents of present Rawlsburg students and the community members at large, only because when you look at the parents of present Rawlsburg students, you've got, you know, kindergarten through, it seems like it's disequal representation on that committee for parents that have students for just, you know, 5 years and maybe more if they have multiple children versus community members at large that have come in such great numbers to have real opinions about this. And so that would just be my only recommendation, is to at least either increase the community members at large or flip-flop those numbers between the parents.
I also am grateful for this and like it very much, so thank you for the time that you put into this. And I think adding a community member is fine if that's you know, what the administration would like to do. The only thing about this that I support it as is, but I would like to, it is my hope, the only thing that gives me pause is it is my hope that whatever the committee comes back to the board with offers enough variety where board members' thoughts on whether it's named after an individual or a place or whatever, that they can find something to support in there, so that there's variety in those three. And the reason I ask for that is, you know, I personally am not at this point, although certainly could be convinced otherwise, but right now I would lean towards not having a school named after an individual. So I only say that as an example to suggest that other board members may have similar thoughts the other way. And so if there's a variety to choose from, I hope that is possible.
Any other board member discussion on the potential process or the draft process? With that, for me, I'm certainly not adverse to naming it for an individual. I think that kind of gives a sense of community and helps to kind of give some history and some local history to our schools. So I would hope that we would have a variety. Now the procedure, the process here does say that we get the three potential names, but we don't have to choose from those three names. We can choose, we can go some other direction. I would tell them that they probably should get something that rhymes with penguin or something, because there's some attachment to the penguin, it draws birds, so, and whatever mechanism or mechanisms they choose to solicit input from the community, whether they want to do a website, or they want to do a survey, or they want to do both, or whatever, to solicit ideas for the name, I would hope that that information obviously would be provided to the board as well. So thank you for you and your team for putting this together. You know, one of the other parts about why it's impossible to move quickly is you have to garner public input on these issues and these matters, and getting that public input and appropriately considering the name is just going to is going to take a little time. So Mrs. Cook leaning towards the microphone.
I have a question about process. So does this require board action, or can the board consensus up here give the administration the authority to move forward?
I would say we probably should do action.
It'll be on the agenda at the next
meeting. Agenda at the next meeting, yeah.
Okay.
But I would think that the administration should have enough, should have some confidence to move, that we can move forward and begin the process. Go ahead.
Just to be clear, as I look at the process and look to revising it, we will add a community member at large.
Yes, I would.
If you could go back to your discussion about Mrs. Cook's discussion about options.
Yep.
Are you looking for us to write something into this process to ensure that?
No, thank you for asking. I view what, where, solidly in the administrative realm. So I just felt at the front end that I wanted to express my desire to have a variety so that this body can, but no, I don't think it requires that. If the community comes back and says, no, we want, these are the three individuals we want, then okay.
So we're not going to, again, just to make sure I got it, we're not going to alter this process to have any, this process is enough board input to begin. We don't need to add any language that changes, modifies, or adds any further school board input.
No,
correct.
I don't think so.
Yes,
but I would agree adding the three community members at large.
Yes. And I'm wondering if you could say upon acceptance of at least three potential names, because then that leaves it a little open to if there's like, you know, a tie between three and four, then give us four. It just gives us a little more flexibility.
Give us six.
Oh, I know, but
can
at
you
least,
say that again?
Upon, just add at least, upon acceptance of at least.
A minimum of.
Or a minimum of.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Are we good? We know what's going to be on the agenda for the next meeting? Okay. 8.02, authorization of purchase of laptops for the scheduled middle school laptop program expansion. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Kelly, members of the board. This is a budgeted item to the expansion of the one-to-one laptop, the personalized learning process that we have undergone in the last few years, and Mr. Landers is here to tell you a little bit about it and answer any questions you might have.
Good evening, Mr. Landers.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. This evening, we're asking for your consideration and approval of purchasing student laptops per school board policy DJ that requires board approval of purchases in excess of $50,000. As the board is aware, we're in the third year of the middle school personalized learning one-to-one laptop program. And this year, we are expanding that program to include grades 6 and 7 at both Hornsby and Berkeley Middle Schools and grades 6, 7, and 8 at Tuano Middle School. The cost for this expansion is included in the school board's adopted fiscal year 17 budget in the Technology Cost Center, and the cost to purchase laptops is $900,000. This purchase will provide 1,800 laptops, including the expanded three-year service and warranty. Thank you, and I'll be happy to answer any questions at this time.
Any questions from board members?
For clarification, we're using a cooperative purchasing contract, which means exactly what?
Yes, ma'am. We've used that contract previously for the high school refresh this past spring. The cooperative contract means that the contract has already been vetted, approved by cooperating locality school divisions, and that they have included the language in that contract to allow us to use the contract that has already gone through. It also means that it has been reviewed and met local purchasing requirements.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Ms. Hummel?
I just had a question about the, for the upcoming school year, the purchase will provide laptops to grades 6 and 7 at Berkeley and Hornsby and grades 6, 7, and 8 at Toano. Does Berkeley and Hornsby, 8th graders, do they already have laptops, or is...
No, ma'am, they don't. The only reason for that differentiation is that, I believe it was 2 years ago, we started the initial pilot program at 6th grade at Toano Middle School, and since then, we've had the funding to basically beef it up by one grade level per year. So Toano's just a little bit ahead because of that.
So they started it.
They started earlier.
Okay, got it. Okay.
Ms. Cook?
Yeah, a comment and then a process question. I have just anecdotally two children at Berkeley, one who benefited from the program and one who's just 1 year too old. And it's just the difference is really amazing. And so it's just an incredible opportunity for these kids to have their own devices and do their project work on them. And it's been amazing to watch. But my process question, Mr. Chair, is if, assuming there's consensus on the board, would this then go into, because it's a cooperative contract, into the consent agenda at the next meeting? Is that...
Sure. I mean, as long as it's approved at the next meeting. So if we approve this at the next meeting, which would be the 16th, and school starts about a day and a half after that, when would these laptops actually show up and be available for the...
We have already planned, scheduled for actually releasing these laptops in some locations in late September, in others in October, just to coincide. We don't hit them day one when the students hit the doors because we have to have time to do the training, do the familiarization, that kind of thing. So we've staged it out a little bit, so we'll be okay as far as the timeline.
So 6 and 7, Berkeley and Hornsby, 6, 7, and 8. So how many total laptops is that? Is that, that's not the 1,800, is it?
I can do the math in my head. 300 per grade, basically. So 3, 6, 12. Now, there's another 300 that's not accounted for that we're repurposing. I believe 300.
What impressed me the first, the pilot year of this program is that we gave these laptops to 6th graders, and I had 3 6th graders at one point, and they couldn't find their pencils in the morning. And yet we had no, the laptops themselves, they took such great care of them. There was no abuse, breakage, and I was, or at least a minimal amount, and I was very impressed with how those 6th graders, the responsibility they had with that, that just kind of tells you the value that they put on that device. And so I think this is a great program and a great thing for our middle school students. I'm very excited.
Absolutely. The students have done a tremendous job as the teachers and working with the students.
The days of I lost my homework are over.
Oh, yeah, by the way. So
I have one other question.
Yes, ma'am.
So is the plan for next year that the purchase, there will be another board action item to purchase laptops for Berkeley and Hornsby for grade 6, and then at that point all of the middle schools will be covered for all 3 years?
We will work through that in the upcoming budget cycle. But certainly that is going to be brought forth to the board for consideration.
Right. It's on Richmond. Dr. Constantino.
Just to remind the board that when we were in a position in May to have to trim the budget, you might recall that the original request was higher to get through 8th grades. But we had to make some decisions, and the board was very clear on their priority for reducing the budget. So I would anticipate that there'll be a request. And ultimately, if you recall, back a few years ago, the ultimate goal was to have a program that went from grade 6 through 12. So I would imagine if you continue to support that, you'll see several years of budget requests to ensure that all secondary students have access to the laptop.
Has Ms. Berta's office actually done the long-range forecasting on costs for the school division? Do you have any idea? Well, if you don't, that's fine right now, but I think it would be helpful before we go into the next budget session to have an idea of what kind of investment we're making over the long term, so we know what kind. It's part of a priority now. If we're investing in this, then it's going to have to be a budgetary priority, and it'd be good to know what that priority is going to cost us.
So really moving forward, it wouldn't be next year asking for 6th and 7th at Berkeley and Hornsby. The idea is that this is going to follow these students into high school.
That's what the hope is, yes, ma'am.
Okay. So it would be another 1,800 laptops next year.
Well, not necessarily. Some of these laptops will be able to be repurposed because we're just buying them, and we have a 3-year warranty, so we're not going to have to buy that 1,800 every year. What we'll be looking at is what grade levels do we want to expand by, and then we would have to buy laptops for that expansion.
That'll be a budget decision going forward, because as laptops age out the 3-year warranty, they need to be replaced, and so
right.
Do you have to?
Yeah, we're looking at, you know, historically I've brought to the board every year a refresh cycle,
right.
And that's what this will be rolled into as part of that refresh cycle, and right. What it will cost the division.
Right. Okay. Any other questions, comments?
My only other observation is that Ms. Taylor and I had an opportunity to see the laptops with the youngsters when we toured Towanda Middle School, and I saw them with the youngsters at Hornsby, and it's interesting how the teachers use it and how the students engage. So it's very different instructionally, but the students are really attached to it and come quickly to how to use the information. So I have to say I am impressed, and along with the fact that they take good care of them and they all arrive with them in hand.
Yep.
Maybe not charged, but with them in hand.
Right. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
8.3, Virginia Juvenile Detention Center Statewide Secondary Online Course Curriculum. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. WJCC Schools is a fiscal agent for Merrimack Regional Detention Center, which is a state-operated program funded through the Virginia Department of Juvenile Justice. The Juvenile Detention Center administrators have selected an online course curriculum for use in all juvenile detention education centers statewide. This money is money that is coming directly from the Virginia Department of Education, but because we are the fiscal agent, we are required to ensure that the board sees and approves this. But this would be in the category of pass-through funds. You've seen board items before in which funds are passed through, but for your knowledge and your vote and your approval, and Mrs. Bourgeois is here to take you through it.
Evening, Mrs. Bourgeois.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board, and Dr. Constantino. As Dr. Constantino said, we are the fiscal agent for Merrimack Juvenile Educational Center, and I do have with me this evening John Whalen, who is the supervisor of that educational program. The proposed contract will provide online curriculum access to all of the state detention centers, and the money has been appropriated at the state level. Purchase of this online content will provide curriculum in the areas of language arts, math, science, social studies, career and technical education, general studies, health and PE, humanities, world languages, and life skills for students in grades 6 through 12. The total cost is $145,061.80. This also is a cooperative contract, and the contract has been reviewed both by our finance department and by James City County Purchasing Department.
Thank you. Any questions from board members?
So for clarification, there is no local money attached to the purchase of this agreement.
Okay. No, ma'am.
Correct.
Thank
you. Mr. Whalen took the lead on doing this process for all the state detention centers, so it has been assigned to our locality.
Great. Any other questions from board members?
Just that same process question about putting this in the consent agenda, if that's...
I have no problem with putting it in the consent agenda.
Yeah, that'd
agenda.
Be fine.
Just for my education, how many people are served?
In the state of Virginia, there are 26 juvenile detention centers and 6 state hospitals that will be served by this.
Great.
So student-wise depends on day-to-day because of the, you know, the varying population Kids come and go every day, but somewhere in about 1,000 kids a day we see across the state.
Right. And how does that relate back to their local school system? I mean, is for credits, and I guess it's an online curriculum. So
sure, absolutely. And more and more kids that we're seeing at the Juvenile Detention Center are in night school programs in their locality, and a lot of those programs use online programs. So it's a smoother transition for kids as they come to us, and if they're with us for 2 weeks and leave, it really reduces the gap in their education.
Sure, that's great. Great. Worthwhile program. Thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you. 8.04 fiscal year 2018 proposed budget calendar. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. We're bringing the budget calendar to you a little earlier this year, largely to ensure that the new process for the capital improvement plan is clear and written and something that we can communicate. There was the board's concern that they wanted to make sure that there was public input, opportunity for public input into the CIP. So we're bringing this early. Ms. Berta will take you through that calendar, and we'll ask for your approval at the next meeting.
Good evening, Ms. Berta.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. Before you is the 2018 budget calendar. We have started the CIP development committee process, and with that being said, by the 20th of September, we anticipate bringing to you those recommendations from that capital improvement development committee. Following that presentation, we are proposing a public hearing on October the 4th to have the public input on those recommendations. By October 18th, we are asking the school board to prioritize the recommended capital improvement plan items for presentation to the county and the city. On November the 15th, we are recommending another public hearing following the prioritization of those items so that you have an opportunity to hear from the public again, with the final adoption date on December 13th. That will give us time to pass that on to our funding partners and the Planning Commission to make sure that we are following their processes and have a smoother CIP transition. Continuing on, we will have a board retreat at your pleasure in January with a date to be determined, a pre-budget public hearing on January the 17th, the presentation of the superintendent's proposed operating budget on February the 7th, a joint meeting with the city and county sometime in March of 2017, a date to be determined, a public hearing on March 7th of 2017 to discuss the operating budget, approval of the school board's proposed operating budget for passing to the funding partners on March 21st, and then final adoption of our budget, operating budget for fiscal year 2018 on May 16th. I will be happy to answer any questions, comments.
Questions from board members?
I don't have any questions, but I just want to thank you for this. I think this is an improvement, I think, and obviously you put an awful lot of thought into this, so thank you very much.
Ms. Cook?
Yeah, I'd like to echo Mrs. Young's thanks. This is really a wonderful document, and you won't be surprised to hear this from me, and I understand that this document is about that which is in our purview and our control, but I want us to never forget the other pieces and the planning commissions for our funding bodies and the Board of Supervisors and City Council. So, and I don't know how to, and I know now it's way too early, but at some point as this progresses, to you always keep that in front of the board on what's coming up in the steps.
It's definitely a fluid document. These are just recommendations. Of course, they're a year out,
yeah.
So it's hard to predict what's going to happen in a year. However, this is definitely a fluid document, and we would bring updates back to the board as necessary.
This is really wonderful. Thank you.
This calendar hasn't been developed in a vacuum, obviously. Have we worked with the county and the city on the CIP process and the planning commissions to make sure that this meets the needs? Because I think there was some issue last year with, I know at least the county's planning commission and how things were presented and what was presented. And I think there was some miscommunication on both sides of that.
Yes.
That barrel, so I just want to make sure.
As part of our capital improvement development committee, we do have a plan to have discussions with both the finance director from the city and the county, as well as representation from the planning committee. So we do have internal meetings that we've already started pre-planning for and scheduling on the calendars so that we have those together, and we'll be prepared for that this year.
Great. So the city and the planning commissions are all on board with that, and they understand what we're doing?
Yes.
That's great. Anything else?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Ms. Berta. 8.05, local plan for the gifted 2016 to 2021. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members of the board, several meetings ago, you were introduced to the local plan for the gifted and its revision process. And at that time, we told you that it would go through a period of vetting and discussion, and that you would see it again in August with an update of what has happened since that time. And Ms. Shepherd is here to tell you what has or has not happened from that meeting until today.
I can say it's August.
Good evening, Mrs. Shepherd.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the school board, Dr. Constantino. It is a pleasure to return to provide follow-up information related to the local plan of the gifted. In June, updated components of the new cycle of the local plan were shared with you. As you're aware, local school boards are required by the regulations governing educational services for gifted students to approve a comprehensive plan for the education of identified gifted learners. Following the initial presentation in June, both a parent meeting, which was attended by 8, and a gifted resource teacher meeting attended by 9 were held. In addition, for 4 weeks, a survey was posted on the division website and advertised via Facebook and Twitter on several occasions. There were 7 respondents to that online survey. Excuse me. So based on the feedback, 2 minor edits were made to the local plan. On page 17, a change was made reflecting 1 gifted resource teacher, not 2, would score the portfolio section during the screening process. And on page 19, student assistance plan was added. The language will read, schools will provide twice exceptional students with the supports and accommodations specified in their IEP or 504 plan or student assistance plan. The overall feedback was positive for the plan and its components. Much of the feedback addressed procedures and not content. As a result, the Office of Gifted Education will work on reinforcing communication efforts to best inform parents, teachers, staff, and administrators. The goal will be to build capacity, ensure transparency, and meet the needs of students. Inquiries were made regarding additional program offerings. This may be an area to investigate in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions from board members?
I have a question.
Mrs. Young.
You say there was some response to your survey. How many people responded?
7.
And how many gifted students are there in the?
About 1,500.
Wow. Seems like we need to find a way to get more people involved in this. I don't have an answer, so, but it's a thought.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Let's go.
Yeah, I'm just curious about the feedback you received about more program offerings. I'm just curious what people thought.
From different groups, they were asking questions, could we look into more services? And so I think maybe what we'll do is we'll continue having some dialogue with parents, including more folks, and seeing, you know, what is needed by our school community, what's possible,
right,
given the resources we have, both human and fiscal. You know, don't know the answers to that yet, but we'll keep, I think that has to do with the communication piece.
So it wasn't specific to an age group or to a content area, or it was.
It sort of went across different contents, or enrichment, or
okay,
at the K-2 or at the middle school. So I wouldn't say that there was any one specific. It was just a variety of, especially when we were sitting around the parent round table. What about this? What about that? What's a possibility? And then my gifted resource teachers were saying, well, how are we going to support that? And you know,
right,
so you got a lot of input from different perspectives, which I thought was powerful.
This is wonderful. I particularly like the young scholars. Am I getting
emerging
that right?
Scholars?
The emerging scholars. Sorry, and your, you know, commitment to making sure that we're providing services to all gifted children, regardless of what their circumstances may be at home.
Thank you. So.
Any other questions from board members? Thank you, Mrs. Shepherd. I appreciate it. Appreciate
good
your good work in putting this plan together.
Very much.
Thank
good
you.
Work.
8.06 meal price increase for 2016-2017. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. The Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act of 2010, Public Law 111-296, was signed into law by the President on December 13, 2010. The act reauthorized the federal school nutrition programs, including the school lunch and school breakfast programs. Each year, we bring to you school lunch price increases that are based on federal formulas. You are used to seeing Ms. Haley each year come and talk with you. She is on vacation this week, and so Mr. Snipes is going to pinch hit and talk with you about...
So we get the B team, is that what we get?
Lunch price increases.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Snipes.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. As Dr. Constantino said, the act itself is... if the paid lunch price is less than the difference between the federal reimbursement for free lunch and the paid lunch, then we have to increase the prices for our lunches. And we are recommending that that price be an increase of 10 cents. Breakfast prices will also increase by 5 cents, and those breakfast prices will go up to $1.30 for elementary, $1.40 for middle school, and $1.50 for high school. And this will be the first increase in breakfast prices since 2008.
Thank you, Mr. Snipes. Any questions from board members? I think we're good. Thank you. Appreciate it. So section 9 is the policies, and I'm just going to turn it over to
just a question quickly. Can we add the meal price increase and the local plan approval to the consent agenda?
Yes, we can add that to the consent agenda.
Okay.
We're not going to have a meeting.
That brings us to the policies 9. I'm just going to pass it over to Mrs. Cook and Mrs. Young.
Okay.
I just take us through the policies and changes.
So the first one is the conflict of interest. First, I'd like to thank Ms. Serza for her, well, all staff, but Ms. Serza, you've been really wonderful helping us, shepherding us through this process, so thank you. But this is, first few we're looking at are sort of in Ms. Serza's realm, but the BBFA is the conflict of interest, essentially, and you'll see that it's different than the VSBA version, which is lengthier, but after advice from the attorney, really sort of simple is better, and so it's a three line policy, and it's pretty simple
and clear
and clear
and
so
cool.
Yeah,
and
clear,
so
agreed.
So if there aren't any objections, this would then go on the consent agenda as well.
Yep.
So the next one, the advisory committee to the board, there are two, and jump right in anytime, Mrs.
Ma'am.
There are two changes here. The first came, well, actually both came at the request from advisory committees and their reports to us in June, I believe. The first has to do with the length of term for the student advisory committee.
Yep.
They requested 2 years, so these changes accommodate that. And the other was a request to be able to appoint members to the advisory committee throughout the year should the board decide to do so, and so the language accommodates that as well.
Do we have a feel for how we would implement the two-year term for the student advisory committee?
Well, I think the students that are on there currently will continue, and then the exiting seniors will. I think that's because the person who was most interested in this was a junior, so he would be a rising senior. But I think it won't be difficult, but I do think that it was their recommendation. It wasn't the advisors on there. It was their recommendation. They just felt it was a much more fluid way of handling, because they just felt that they were just getting to know what was going on, and then they were leaving.
Sure.
So it makes sense.
Yeah, I was just thinking that if we make it so that they are selected freshman year and junior year, you know, if you look at it ongoing, right, you're selected freshman and junior year so that sophomore and senior year are still on there. So the transition period this year, the juniors would juniors from last year would continue on. The sophomores might be for just 1 year to get to, and then we pick new freshmen for 2 years.
Right.
So it's some we have to work out some transition plan, to understanding how what the go forward position would be, which if they're up for 2 years, that would be a freshman and junior year selection.
That's a good idea, and I think we need to ask staff to.
Let Mrs. Bourgeois figure that out. Mrs. Bourgeois says she'll figure it out. So, great. Is any other concerns with this? Do you want to add that to the consent agenda?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Sorry. I spoke.
And then policy DJ? Or are we, no, BDDG, sorry.
BDDG, yes. Yeah. So this is minutes, and this has been updated to take the word microfilm out of
No, I like the old microfilm when you spin it.
And so anyway, and then alterations about closed meetings that were based on attorney recommendation. So
they will not be required.
So we've been doing it on the rolled microfilm or on the flat ones that you had. I am so dating myself right now.
So we'll get microfilm out of there.
Good idea.
Assuming everybody's okay with that, we put it on the. No one's attached to microfilm. We'll put that in the consent.
It was originally adopted in 1974.
It was revised in 01, though.
1970.
Microfiche was kind of on its way out in 01, but that's another issue. Okay.
And then the next one is purchasing. Thank you.
Hello again. Policy DJ is before you requesting an amendment. This was adopted in August of 1982 and last revised in October of 2013. We are requesting a change to create continuity between the school board and county purchasing policy, since there are shared services with James City County for the purchasing department. Currently, the policy requires that we come to the board for approval at $50,000 or greater. The county allows purchases up to $100,000 to be signed by the county administrator and executed without board approval. However, he does provide a report to the board about what those transactions are, so you are informed. This change would allow us to have a more efficient operations environment, particularly for summer projects, because many of our projects are below $100,000. And that requirement to come back to you and present that for two meetings does put the timeline a little tighter. So we are requesting a change in purchasing authority for the superintendent or designee to sign contracts up to $100,000. There is a change that I have added under number 2. It's actually line 20 and 21 of the policy that very clearly defines that all professional services, included but not limited to engineering services, anticipated to be in excess of $100,000, requires competitive negotiation. I think it's important for us to put that in the policy so it's clear our staff what the expectation is. So there are changes in here throughout to allow us to have $100,000 signing authority. The recommended changes have been reviewed by the James City County Purchasing Office, the School Board Policy Committee, and our legal counsel. I will tell you that our policy is a little bit lengthier than the VSBA policy. The reason for that is I think we need to provide clear guidance to our staff on what the expectations are at different purchasing thresholds, and the VSBA policy does not do a good job of doing that. It strictly talks about the $100,000 threshold. So we have strengthened this, and County Purchasing and I are working on the regulation to go along with this upon your approval to make sure that we clearly define to staff what the expectation is for purchasing.
Board members, discussion?
I like having the $50,000 as a new board member, just because it really allowed me to see what
what's going on in the school system. As a new board member, I kind of liked being able to look at things that were 50,000 or more, and this doubles that. It's not like a, it's a pretty major increase from 50,000 to 100,000. I might be the only one that feels that way, but for me, as a new board member, I look at, oh, what is the, oh, 50,000. 50,000 is a lot of money to me. And so I'm probably, I don't know, I'm interested in everybody else's opinion about that. I've liked having things come up for $50,000 because it's like, oh, okay.
I think one of the things that when we were discussing this, the there's an attempt to have more cooperation between the school accounting finance office and the county, and I think that was kind of the precursor to making that decision so that things were more in alignment, since we are trying to align some of our policies and practices with the county so that we are more cooperative. We're not, we haven't, we're attempting to do a better job.
I think if our policy is aligned with the county's, that it leaves less room for error. And so that's, so we're, this, if I'm correct, is aligning us with them. And since they do our procurement, that's, that could, again, lead to error.
Right. To Mrs. Hummel's point, though, any purchases between 25 and 100 will still be included in our monthly financial reports.
That's correct.
And so it will still be there for you to look at, question, and ask if, for what that, what those purchases would be.
So they're in the
monthly financial
reports.
Right.
On that last page.
Last page is where they have all the significant purchases.
Okay.
So that you can.
The last page of the financial report currently talks about checks issued. I'm actually going to be adding a new layer to the financial report that shows when contracts are executed, so that you will have the ability to see those contracts between zero and 100,000. So.
That's really good.
That's nice. So we know that after we took action that we've actually expended or not expended the funds.
Right.
Okay. Or, yeah, or if it was in the budget.
Yeah, yeah. And I think if we're in a cooperative agreement with the county for purchasing, that being aligned makes, our policy being aligned makes a lot of sense. I understand Ms. Humble's concern, but I think if that reporting is there, we're good to go.
I would say, because we're talking about funding levels and spending levels and dollars, that I would not add this to the consent agenda. I'd put this as an action item to vote on, because that's one of the most important things that the board does. Is with the any other policy things? I know Mrs. Cook recognized Mrs. Serza for her work in helping shepherd through the policies, and I would certainly like to do that as well. But I'd also like to thank Mrs. Young and Mrs. Cook for taking that arduous task on with the list of policies that are out there to be reviewed. I know that's a.
We have a lot more. We do. Yes. Just for you.
Good thing neither of you are going anywhere for a while. So with that, that takes us to 10.01, board members' comments. Is there any comments from board members this evening? Ms. Young?
Okay. First of all, I just want to congratulate Dr. Constantino on his opportunity to affect change throughout the state. I think that's a great opportunity for him. And secondly, to welcome Dr. Heron as our interim superintendent. I'm very pleased about that. I think she's had good mentorship, and I think she will bring a different dimension to the county, so I'm excited about that. Maybe I should have made this statement during announcements, but yesterday we met with the JCC portion of the liaison committee, and we had Ruth Larson and Sue Sadler, who are the Board of Supervisor representatives, Dr. Heron, myself, and Brian Hill was there. And we talked about the purpose of the liaison committee. The next joint liaison committee between the city and the county is going to be on the 21st, September 21st. And at that meeting, one of the things that we will have been asked to bring or and have proposed also is that we, we'll be discussing enrollment, because that will be after the opening of school, and enrollment projections, the budget process, which Christina Berta presented tonight, and then last of all, providing some information about the superintendent search, so that they understand the process a little bit better. So if anybody has anything that you would like relayed to that, if you'll please provide that information to Mrs. Cook or myself, that would be helpful to us. 21st, September 21st.
Ms. Meyer?
Let me say that wish Dr. Constantino well. I know that this is his last meeting with us, though I know he'll be here for a few more days as we go through the many moves of furniture and things back to James Blair. But let me just say that I think you have an opportunity to serve the Commonwealth well in redesigning how we teach our children for the 21st century across the Commonwealth, and hopefully can find opportunities to do that. And I have enjoyed working with you these few months, and wish you well on your way. And also like to thank Dr. Herron for being willing to step up and take the challenge of working with the board and the community with lots of exciting things, among them starting school again very briefly and the construction project. So I look forward to our working together. And that's about it for me. But yes, thank you to Ms. Young and Ms. Cook and Ms. Sirza and the other members of the policy committee for bringing these forward. It's funny to see that the last time many of them were there was many years ago when I was new on the board, the last time.
You were so just a little girl.
I was young and slimmer. But anyway, but thank you, because it's been a while since anybody's taken a good look at all of this, and yikes.
There's some good look needed. Mrs. Taylor?
So I would like to thank Dr. Constantino for his service to the division and education as a whole. And thank you to Dr. Herron for stepping up to be the interim superintendent. I know she's up to the task, and I appreciate having someone with current knowledge of Williamsburg James City County schools, policies, procedures, and staff here with us as we transition into new leadership.
I also would like to echo everyone's thanks and appreciation to Dr. Constantino for his tenure with us, and I know he's going to do great things in Richmond, and he's going to remember WJCC fondly when it comes to policy and anything else that he can do. So we're very appreciative of that, and I also know that there is a lot on Dr. Herron's plate, and we very, very much appreciate you stepping up and agreeing to be the acting superintendent. And please, please ask us if there's anything we can do to support you in the coming months.
I have a few comments. I wanted to just say that I enjoyed going to the Virginia Department of Education hearing at Lafayette High School. Was that 2 weeks ago? It was, this community was well represented, and so it was nice to see that, and appreciate the department coming to our area and allowing that opportunity. Also, Dr. Constantino reported on the award that this division won at the Classrooms Not Courtrooms conference, and how good the conference was. It was good, but I think the biggest takeaway, and I'll write a little something for you guys so you can I can share what I learned there, but I think the biggest takeaway for me was a sense of tremendous pride for this division, not only because of the award, but we had a huge, just a very large group. It was hosted by the state, so there wasn't a cost associated with it, but I would dare say we had the largest contingent. We had, I think, 15 people from the division, I think, which is an indicator of how committed this division is to educating all children. And then just listening to other board members when in the sessions about policy, it was affirmed that we're really on the right track. We may not be cutting edge, but we're certainly leading edge, and that's a real testament to the people who are working in the classrooms and in the buildings every day. It's a big deal. So thank you to everyone who does that work. Steve, thank you. Best of luck. I will miss you, and you've done great things for this division, and I'm excited to see you do great things at the state. And Dr. Herron, thank you. Looking forward to working with you. You're going to do great things. Thank you.
Thank you. It's interesting. In August, where most people put down the summer, they're, you know, go on vacation and go to the beach, and there's a lot of important things that that were discussed and completed this board meeting tonight, from Dr. Constantino's resolution, appointment of Dr. Heron, tuition for non-residents, middle school laptop, and proposed budget. Here it is August, and the work of the school system must continue. There must be those who work. I appreciate the efforts of the board members to put the effort in to prepare for each and every agenda item today. I thank the administration, Dr. Constantino and his staff for preparing these items. It takes a lot of effort to get the schools ready to open and to get these decisions made, and I appreciate everybody's energy to prepare for the opening of school. I received an email today from Clarence Wilson from the Education Foundation, and he was, I don't know that he was concerned, he just wanted to make sure that as we go forward into our superintendent search, that we continue to place emphasis on the Education Foundation. I know how Dr. Heron feels about the Education Foundation and the importance of it. That has been something that the school board has fought for a long time, to organize that and to make that the success that it has been in its first year. The whole foundation, you really couldn't tell that it was in its first year as professionally as it was run, as the support that you had, the breakfast that we had at Ford's Colony to kick it off, and the number of people and the people who were there, it was just a very impressive event. The foundation is an important part of our school system. It's an important part of our community, actually. The foundation, when we went to distribute those grants in January, it was very impressive to see the teachers, when they receive, was generally speaking, not really a large amount of money, $500,000, that kind of thing, but to see the impact that it had on those teachers, that they were appreciated, that they knew that their initiative was going to go forward, I think was amazing. But what was more amazing to me is that the foundation provides an avenue for the community to become engaged in our schools and for the community to support our schools. So the Education Foundation is an important part of, I think, the work of this board. It's an important part of this community. It will certainly be a permanent part of this community and get the support of whoever this board chooses to be superintendent, because I think they need to know that is a non-starter and a crux. We have, as far as the superintendent search, we are in the beginning stages of that. We are looking at getting proposals from various search firms to assist us in the search, and so there'll be more on that going forward. As far as Dr. Constantino's departure, I think I've said enough through the board meeting. We still have a couple of things to settle, so I know he's not going to go very far. because I'm not going to forget any of that. And I also thank Dr. Heron for agreeing to be our acting superintendent. I think that she is highly capable and will provide stability and leadership where it is necessary and needed. With that, upcoming events, the policy committee meeting is meeting August 9th at 1:30 in the Stryker Center. We have our convocation August 26th at 8:30 at Williamsburg Community Chapel. School liaison committee meeting September 9th, 4:00, hosted by the City of Williamsburg, in a location to be determined. The policy committee is meeting again on September 13th. At 1:30 in the Stryker Center, and we have the VSBA Legislative Advocacy Conference September 14th in Charlottesville, and somewhere in there the opening day of school is September 6th. So I hate to tell all those students that are watching the meeting that it's coming. So we also don't tell when our teachers are arriving, but they don't want to hear that anyway. Upcoming meetings, August 16th, here in Building F, we start with a closed session at 6 o'clock and a regular meeting at 6:30. And then September 2nd.
I think it's September 6th. I think that's a typo.
You think it's a typo. First Tuesday in September, whatever the opening day of school is, that's when we're going to have another board meeting. September 6th at 6 o'clock here in Mounts Bay, and at 6 o'clock of the closed session, and at 6:30 we have a work session on September 6th. With that, Mrs. Serza, I think we understand what our board meeting is going to look like next time.
Yes.
For the work session. Go ahead. Okay. And with that, we are adjourned. Thank you.